Subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon to never miss an update.
There are so many businesses in this world which actually run on the last mile salesperson even today. Whether it is retail or it is banking or insurance or so many things, especially in our country, still run with the last mile salesperson making the sale. How has the new rules of business changed for this salesperson?
I think what you were trying to indicate was that the job of a salesperson is to sell, sell, sell and sell more, irrespective of what the customer's requirement is. So let's do a role play, right? You're in the business or you're a customer and you want to buy a pen, right? A medium price pen. I am in the business of selling pen, but my company only makes an expensive pen. After understanding your requirement, I know that this does not fit you, but being in the traditional old mindset, I am going to move heaven and earth to actually sell this pen to you. And the more aggressive I become, the more you're going to move away from me.
The more I'm going to get turned off.
Right. But in the new scheme of things or in the new rules, what it tells me for a salesperson is that you are not a salesperson, but you are a sales consultant. What is the job of a sales consultant? Is to understand your requirement. It is a medium price pen. And if I don't have it, then what do? I don't try and sell this pen to you, but use my network to make sure that you get the pen of your choice. A new age salesperson who's a sales consultant, his job is not to sell, but to help customer achieve their objective. Your objective was medium price pen and I have helped you achieve it. So how have I gained? When you got what you were looking for, I generated in you two concepts of behavioral sciences. One is likability and second is reciprocal.
Right.
If I have helped you and protected your interest, would you like me, Kunj, or dislike me?
No, I would like you.
And next time when you have a requirement for pen and I'm in the pen business, who would you reach out to?
I would probably reach out.
So you will reciprocate my goodness. Instead of me running after the customer is running after me. Is that not what the job of a salesperson is?
But the ground reality is that, you know, businesses today have monthly targets, quarterly targets. Every week on a Monday morning, the sales head sits and says, kitna targets achieved kiya hai.
Bilkul.
At that time, nobody is thinking long term, right? Like,
yes.
So much mis-selling happens in insurance all over the country today. And it happens because people are chasing short-term goals.
Absolutely.
So how do you structure businesses that we follow the right metrics so that these kinds of things don't happen?
New age companies don't look at revenue as an indicator of the health. But what do? It is called three letters, NPS, Net Promoter Score. What is Net Promoter Score? On a weekly basis, on a fortnightly basis, on a monthly basis, in fact, in real time, companies are sending out survey forms to their actual customers and asking them a simple question. How likely are you to recommend our business to your friends and to your relatives? And what is the job after they have collected this? To maximize NPS, right? Not just NPS. There's a second concept that is also gaining ground among new age companies, and that is called customer effort score. There was a bank with whom we were banking, and I'm an entrepreneur and we needed funds to expand the business.
Right.
So we went down to the bank and we said we want a loan. Oh, they were eager. They came to my house, to my office to offer loans. They made me feel so awesome. But once the loan was dispersed and they sent me details, what did I realize? That some of the documents which I had handed over as collateral, original documents, was not there in the mail that they sent me. And when I pointed this out to them, they first put the onus on me and they blamed me. Finally, when they discovered that it was their mistake, they did not even apologize. Whenever I need to get service now, after the loan has been dispersed, it is not they who are running after me, it is I who have to run after them. Now, how can a company capture this frustration of a customer like me? So this is called customer effort score. How much effort does the customer have to actually engage in to get himself or herself serviced? So, Kunj, to answer your question, new age companies don't look at revenue as a sole indicator of the health of the company. There are two metrics and both of them are customer-centric metrics. Maximize NPS, minimize customer effort score. If that happens, your business is healthy and you're going to go places.
So far, we've talked about how these companies conduct their business with the outside world. But to conduct that kind of business, the internal structures, the workplace that people are working in also needs to align with the new rules of business. So how do you think the workplace, the organization structure has changed today to align with the new rules of business?
When you walk into Google as an employee, you don't need to go out of the office. Lunch is served, dinner is served, snack is served.
And really good lunch at that.
Yeah, awesome lunch.
Yeah.
Second, you don't even need to go out for the gym. It's right inside. Occasionally, when you want haircut, that's also available right there. Now, Kunj, if you worked in Google, how would you feel? Happy or unhappy?
Very happy.
Very happy. Now, because everything is available within that premise, will you spend more time in Google's office or less time?
More time.
More time.
And hence, they will get more work out of me.
You said it. Now, as an employee, you are happy and you are spending more time. Like you, majority of Google employees are happy and spending more time. If more and more employees spend more time and are happy, what are the consequences on work? They will work with passion, they will work with their heart, they will work in a collaborative manner, they will be creative because there is no stress. Right. So the new rule, don't have office. Office and workplace have transformed into fun place.
Habits, cultures of various countries or various civilizations also change over time, and hence they also impact how businesses are run. Can you give me an example where that has impacted a particular industry that has been around for a long time, but it has had to play by different rules today?
I started my career in alcoholic beverage way back in 80s and 90s. When I started, I used to handle a very popular brand called Backpiper.
Okay.
Right? And when we did research among our customers, what did we realize? That people in India actually wanted to drink alcohol only to get high, and predominantly, which means more than 99.999% drinkers were male. So male drinkers drinking in the evening, wanting to get high.
And they want to get there quickly. That's why they feel bang for the buck.
They wanted bang for the buck. So Backpiper actually suited these requirements, and Backpiper became India's largest and at some point in time, the world's largest.
Wow.
But things changed after liberalization. And what happened was a very subtle change. More and more women started entering the workforce, and I realized that there's going to be a shift in the way people consume alcohol. No longer will people consume alcohol to get high, but they will consume alcohol as a way for socializing. And when mixed company drinking happens, then people can't get high. They need to remain within quotes sober, right?
Right.
And therefore, I had anticipated that the shift in alcohol will happen from hard liquor towards softer option, which is white spirits, let's say vodka, white rum, beer, and other low alcoholic beverages. And that is exactly the way it's happening. And wines, right? So if you go back to 90s and you went to a restaurant, wine did not figure in their menu. And today when you go there, there's a menu card dedicated to wine.
The market is developing for say white liquor in India. Let's take for example beer, because that's my favorite. But so within beer, if a foreign brand is coming into India, what are some of the rules that it has to play by?
International brands have not made that much headway in our beer market. What's the reason? The reason is you, the Indian customer. What do Indian customers want? Simple. They want something that is sweeter in taste and which is heavy. Heavy means paisa vasool. But if you go back to the European beers, that's where beer is very famous.
Right.
Those beers are lighter and bitter. Now, Kunj, here you are, who is fed on a beer which is sweeter and heavier, and there comes an international brands, right, which you actually pick up and you actually sip because you were actually aspiring for those brands, and suddenly you discover it is bitter and it is lighter.
Yeah.
You will not in 21st century adopt or change your taste to meet their requirement. You just say, I don't like you.
It comes from my childhood, right? Like my idea of a nice beverage or a celebratory beverage is something sweet. And my idea of a bitter beverage is kadha, which I have when I am six.
Sick,
you know?
Right? So you said it. An international brand came to India. And as Indians, we love the international image, but we did not like the brew. So what did this international brand do? Very simple. It kept its international image intact, but it actually modified its brew to suit the Indian requirement. Which
so
is
same like packaging, same
international
look, everything.
International. But the brew inside is Indian, right?
It's
heavier
sweeter,
and sweeter. Heavier. But is this restricted only to beer? No. You come to McDonald's.
Yeah.
Burger in any part of the world means beef. In India, beef is a taboo. It'll cause a riot outside McDonald's. So what did they do? They adopted to the cultural sensitivity of our country and they serve chicken burger. Not just McDonald's, there is Domino's, MTV, there's a whole host of international brands who now follow what is becoming popular and a new rule is called global strategy. Have a global strategy but localized to meet the local condition wherever the brands operate.
Marketeers have always used cultural hot buttons to push their brand out. So whether it's music or actually comedy lately in India has been that route that a lot of marketers have started using. So firstly, what is behind this crazy stand-up comedy or just overall comedy boom in this country today? And also, how are marketeers using it and why are they choosing to use comedy today?
All of us realize that there is a lot of deficiency in us. We have a lot of shortcomings in us, but none of us actually acknowledge it. So what are these stand-up comics doing? They are actually taking up our deficiencies, our incompleteness, and presenting them in a manner that is palatable to us. So when they stand up and perform and we laugh, we are not laughing at them, we are actually laughing at ourselves. If you are laughing, are you in a good mood or bad mood?
Good mood.
And when you are in a good mood and a brand is making you, is presenting the comic so that you are in a good mood, what will happen to that brand? Will it be associated with laughter or will it be associated with pain in your mind?
Laughter.
Any brand which gets associated in a customer's mind as being a fun brand has chances of the customer asking for it or making an effort to pick it out.
Right.
So that's the reason why marketeers are going. Technology has entered comedy. You know how comics are likely to be paid in the future? There will be an AI, artificial intelligence algorithm, which will measure when the comic is performing, how many times the clap happened, what was the intensity of the clap, how many catcalls happened, and how many whistles happened. Depending on the intensity, duration of the catcalls of the thing, an algorithm will rank all the comics, and depending on who has got maximum, right, catcalls, laugh intensity, they will be paid.
Sir, how has competition changed in today's business scenario?
In 2007, what was the brand of smartphone that you carried or what was the handset that you carried?
Probably a Nokia.
Nokia. Not just you, 67% of the world market was dominated by Nokia. That was 2007. Today, what is the fate of Nokia?
Doesn't exist.
It doesn't exist. Almost does not exist.
Almost
does. And who knocked off Nokia? Was it Motorola? Was it Samsung? Or was it another handset company? It wasn't. It was Apple, at that time a computer and a music company, who came and gave it a deadly blow. And in that resides the answer to what the nature of competition in future will be. Let's step back. Till 2007, competition was direct, visible, and within the industry. So a handset manufacturer competed with other handset manufacturers, right? And you knew who the competitor was. So
right.
It was direct, visible, and within the industry. Come 2007, rules have changed. Competition is indirect, invisible, and cross-industry. Take automobile company.
Yeah.
It was generally said, what is good for General Motors is good for US. Who has dislodged General Motors from its pedestal? Tesla. Tesla again is not from the same industry.
Yeah.
And for General Motors, Ford, Chrysler, and Toyota, it was indirect, invisible, and a cross-industry competitor.
In this world where everything is online and everything is consumed, like data speeds are crazy, why write a book? This is your first book, and why did you choose to take up this medium to reach out to your users?
Kunj, how many years are you going to live?
Hopefully 70 or...
70 years, right?
Yeah.
And do you know how much knowledge is there in the World Wide Web? It can not only submerge you, but it can drown you.
Right.
So the issue is that all the answers are present in the phone that we carry. Right? But the problem is there is so much of information that people are getting drowned. So this book that I have written is an attempt to help you not get drowned, but to give you the essence, the nectar of what is there in the World Wide Web. So what I have done is, I've taken this information, removed the noise, taken the essence and presented in a book form so that you, within about 10 hours, if you go through the book, you will get the essence, you will get a perspective of what the new world is.
Sitting with Rajesh Srivastava and having a conversation has always proven to be valuable for our users, and I don't think this is any different. Thank you so much, sir, for doing this.
Hey, my pleasure, Akwin.